Thank you. Good evening, everyone. My name is Anthony Canape, and I'm the Senior Individual Giving Manager here at Town Hall Seattle. On behalf of the staff of Town Hall Seattle and our friends at Third Place Books and the Institute for Systems Biology, it's my pleasure to welcome you to our presentation with Leroy Hood and Nathan Price with Jim Heath tonight. Hood and Price's new book, The Age of Scientific Wellness, is the subject of our talk tonight. As we get underway, I would like to acknowledge our institution stands on the unceded traditional territory of the Coast Salish people, particularly the Duwamish. We thank them for our continuing use of the natural resources of their ancestral homeland. We're so glad to have you joining us tonight. The presentation will run about 60 minutes, including Q&A. When we get to the Q&A portion of the event, you can ask a question through the mic that is down here right in front of me by the stage, or you can use your smartphone to scan the QR code on the screen and submit your question digitally. We'll drop the link in the chat for those watching online, and you can submit your question at any time. We'll try to get through as many questions as possible, and you can keep asking questions, or sorry, you can help us by keeping your question concise and in the form of a question. Also, a reminder that if you'd like to view the program with closed captions online, please click the CC button in the bottom right corner of the video player. Town Hall is adding new events every single day, and we're also uploading them as podcasts every day. On June 22nd, renowned scientist Peter Glake shares how water has shaped the course of humanity and how we might use it to create a more positive future. And on June 27th, Professor of Philosophy Stephen M. Gardner provides an engaging introduction to climate justice. Visit our website, join our mailing list, or become a member and get the calendar every month for the latest updates as more programs are added throughout the season. Town Hall's work is made possible through your support as patrons and also the support of our sponsors. As part of our Arno G. Matulski Science Lecture Series, this event is supported by Microsoft. Town Hall is, as I mentioned earlier, a member-supported organization, and we love our members, many of whom we see tonight. I'd like to thank all of our members who are joining us. And I'd like to invite you to also become a member if you join in the belief that Town Hall's goal of community energized by considering questions of politics, science, and culture is important. You'll find membership information on our website and also in our lobby downstairs. Lastly, you'll want to dig into tonight's topic by purchasing your own copy of the author's book. You can go downstairs to the lobby where Third Place Books is selling copies, or you can order it online at thirdplace.com. If you're here joining us, there will be a signing in the North Lobby after the event. Dr. Leroy Hood is a well-renowned scientist and a recipient of the National Medal of Science in 2011. Dr. Hood co-founded the Institute for Systems Biology in 2000, served as its first president from 2000 to 2017, and is a professor and chief strategy officer. In 2022, Dr. Hood started Phenom Health, a nonprofit dedicated to delivering value through health innovation. Dr. Nathan Price is CEO of Longevity, a division of Thorne Health Tech. He is also an on-leave professor at the Institute for Systems Biology, where he and Lee Hood co-direct the Hood Price Lab for Systems Biomedicine. Additionally, Dr. Price is an affiliate faculty at the University of Washington in the departments of bioengineering, computer science and engineering, and molecular and cellular biology. Dr. Jim Heath is president and professor at ISB in Seattle. Heath also has the position of professor of molecular and medical pharmacology at UCLA. Formerly, he directed the National Center Institute-funded NSB Cancer Center, was the Elizabeth W. Galoon Professor of Chemistry at Caltech, and served as co-director of the Parker Institute for Cancer Immunotherapy at UCLA until 2017. Please join me in welcoming Leroy Hood, Nathan Price, and Jim Heath to the stage.
Thank you. Are we broadcasting? That's good. So welcome. As I think you just heard, I'm Jim Heath. I'm the president of the ISB. We're an institute that basically tries to do fundamental science as a tool for transforming healthcare. And we're here tonight with my two good friends and colleagues, Nathan Price and Lee Hood, talk about this book, The Age of Scientific Wellness, which I think is no less than a sort of a radical reimagining of what healthcare could be. And I think we'll just start off with, you know, what is scientific wellness? Sort of your term, Lee, so why don't you?
Okay, yeah. Scientific wellness really asks the fundamental question, how do we deal with the complexity of a human being, which is just enormous? And how can we analyze the brain, the body, and the gut, or the microbiome, the three major axes of health today? And each of these has slightly different approaches. For the body, one thing we can do is your entire genome. That's the source code of life that directs your development and the evolution, maturation of your body. But a really interesting question for scientific wellness is, how do we look at all of the internal organs in a human being? And the key there is to realize blood is a window into health and disease. And it is so because it bathes all of the organs which secrete molecules into the blood. And you can quantify those molecules, and they serve as reporters as to how well or diseased all of the different organs are. So the blood analytes, proteins, metabolites, clinical chemistries are key features of studying the body. What about the brain? We feel one of the most important aspects of brain health is your cognition, your ability to think, your reaction time, your judgment, your ability to carry out various kinds of functions. This can be measured by 42 different digital features that can assess 25 major cognitive features, and not only assess them, if they're deficient, it gives us instructions on how to bring them back to their normal state of health. And of course, the third area is the gut microbiome, and there we can use DNA sequencing to analyze the diversity of microbes that are present in your gut microbiome and their inferences about how they handle the management of your food, the metabolism of the drugs you eat. And in fact, we know now that the gut microbiome plays an incredibly important role in health. And of course, what is critical is to take all of this data, which we can easily convert into digital signals, and then use the power of systems biology to transfer these digital signals into the networks that underlie the physiology and the disease of human beings, and to study the dynamics of these networks and how things change, so we can make inferences about how do you optimize wellness or avoid disease. And that's what scientific wellness is all about, using big data to be able to generate actionable possibilities that let an individual optimize wellness and prevent disease.
Well, I would say that, you know, for many years, in fact, until relatively recently, if you wanted to study disease, you almost always found some model system in which to study it. Obviously, that's not the case anymore. The tools are such that you can actually do systems biology in humans. And Nathan, I wonder if you could talk a little bit about what that means in terms of, I mean, if you think about medical school education or even how we think of health as a consumer of healthcare, how does that change? How does the ability to do systems biology in people change that?
Yeah, I think it's really a fundamental issue. So if you think about most of your visits to the doctor, traditionally, there's quite a small number of measurements that are made. And as you look at what we can do now, you can get into radically larger number of measures that we can handle and that you can deal with via AIs and different systems and all kinds of things that we can get into. And so one of the fundamental changes that happens is that we can extract a lot of this information, not even in hospital systems, but right in your own home. And as Lee was alluding to, you know, in scientific wellness, what we're really about is not waiting until you have some horrible disease, but rather understanding what's happening in the body and being able to deal with that complexity and to stop disease before it starts. And that's really what the book is about in that sense. So one of the things that I think is just so fundamental here then is that we do have this capacity now to understand these processes. And one of the key elements is that the key to understanding disease is actually to understand wellness. In fact, I was on a panel with the chairman emeritus of Harvard Medical School right before the pandemic, and he put it in a way that I really liked, which is that healthcare is the only industry that does not study its own gold standard, which is wellness. And so by studying wellness in this way very quantitatively, you understand those earliest transition states, and in fact, the signals there are much more sparse, and you learn a lot about what is causal and what you find out about early that you don't get if you look late.
And so that's actually a great way to put it, doesn't study its own gold standard. I like that. So Lee, when you think about, I think wellness is something that one can think about brain health, one can think about diet, one can think about exercise. How do you define wellness? What does that mean?
That, I think, is absolutely a superb question. And in the past, I think wellness used to be the absence of disease, basically. I think today, because in a program, for example, a company Nathan and I started called Airville, where we looked at 5,000 people over a four-year period, and these were normal people, we and the medical clinics began to define parameters for many of these different data points, the data features that indicate that you're in a state that allows you to optimize your functioning, whether it's body health or brain health or gut microbiome health. So I think wellness is really about being able to identify, and we are more and more clearly doing that, this gold standard that Nathan told us about that gives you insights into the whole body and the whole body's optimal functioning. And I think having the body at a place where it can optimally function is wellness. Now, what I will say about wellness is, my estimate anyway, is the average person is probably at 20 or 30% of the potential wellness they can reach. And there are many different ways that you can exceed that, and that is exactly what this new science of wellness is all about. And the really interesting question comes down to the point one, your wellness is a function of your will to want to be well. And the question you can ask yourself is, how much do you want to push the idea of optimizing the wellness? And where I think that's important and why it should be pushed as much as you have the will to do is because it puts your body in a state to be well for a longer period of time, to, in a sense, let your health span, that is the length you live your life where you're really healthy and functional, equal your lifespan, which is how long you live. And with scientific wellness, we hope to see people moving out into their 90s or even 100 being functionally mentally alert and physically functional.
But we have a healthcare basically infrastructure. It's probably the largest business in the United States that is completely designed around reactive medicine, not proactive medicine. Nathan, can you maybe talk a little bit about how do we change that ship?
Yeah, this is probably the biggest challenge, and it's the part of the book that's probably the most radical, because our whole healthcare system really is centered on this reactionary function. So if you think about that, the people who are entrusted to care for your health are only paid when you're sick. That is mostly true. You know, that the vast majority of healthcare is paid out that way. And, you know, I think it was Richard Feynman or someone that actually says this, that you know, it's very hard to get someone to understand something if their paycheck depends on them not understanding it. So, that makes it hard, right? And so I was at Mount Sinai in New York in their hospital system a couple weeks ago, and we got into a whole big discussion around this. And it's definitely true, because you can talk about prevention, you talk about wellness, everyone kind of a sense that that's a good idea. I mean, one way you think about it, if you could pay the same amount of money to never get Alzheimer's, or pay it to take a drug that slightly decreases the rate of decline, everybody would choose to not have Alzheimer's, right? I mean, it's a no-brainer in that. Well, it's a brainer, right? You actually have one, so that's good. That's a positive. So if you've got that, it becomes this like very difficult issue in the healthcare system, because we have incentivized lots of things that are in fact not good for our health. And so you don't have total alignment in caring for your health from a healthcare system, at least not economically. And this is not an aspersion on any person, right? It's just the way the system is set up. You actually don't have total alignment from your insurance company. You might think that you do, because you say, okay, insurance companies are interested in lowering costs. But that's only kind of true. Because an insurance company, once you've paid the money, yes, they are incentivized to keep that cost down. But over the long run, insurance companies make a percentage of total healthcare spend. So if we were spending a tenth of our economy on healthcare, that's bad for health insurance companies. But we're nearing now one-fifth of every dollar spent in the United States is going to be on healthcare. We're at 18.3, 18.5%, something like this estimate now. So we're getting close. And so if you think about that process, then, so this is why, you know, partly why we wrote the book, because we want to imagine, what does healthcare look like that is actually centered on the extension and expansion of wellness to the full degree possible, rather than a reactive pay-for-disease system? It's incredibly hard to think about changing the healthcare system that way, because of its size and its scope and its power and its inertia and all that's gone into it. But we do believe that by, you know, new companies, new structures, new focus, thinking about different ways of paying, all of these kind of things come into play in terms of trying to imagine a world where we actually achieve what, you know, this preventive medicine that we call scientific wellness.
Could I add one thing to that, Jim?
You may.
Yeah. The other point that I would make is the Airville program for a four-year period with 5,000 people, I think gave us two important insights. One, with this data-driven health, we really can increase the quality of health for each individual. And number two, it started to suggest that there would be some real savings in taking and attacking the science of wellness and the science of prevention rather than dealing with disease. So recently we started a nonprofit called Phenome Health that has as its major initiative a second genome-like project, which proposes over a 10-year period, 1 million people be exposed to this genome-phenome analysis of data we initiated in Airville, and unequivocally lead to the point where we can deal with the major challenges in medicine today and do it entirely from this point of view of wellness on the one hand and prevention on the other hand. And I think a large demonstration project, just as the first genome project has slowly revolutionized medicine, it has taken a long time to begin to realize the actionable possibilities from it, this second genome-like project will validate the power of data-driven health, and I think present a compelling, forceful argument about not only will it improve quality, but it'll save cost, and it'll do it in a way that can be accommodated by the system and in a gradual and efficient way, and we can talk about more about that whole approach.
So let's talk about data for a little bit, because probably the subject that all of us love a lot. We love data. And over the past, decade, things that were basically science fiction, I think for many, many years, the heterogeneity of biology was a confounding factor in trying to interpret biology. That's gone, because now we can do all the measurements we want to do out of single cells. And so, faced with this large amount of data that one can collect, how do we go beyond correlations to look at causations? And I'm thinking in particular about, some diseases like cancer, if you catch it early enough, you can cure it through surgery. And it's only been recently that we've been able to come up with immunotherapies and to harness your own body's tools. And that's still early days yet. But some diseases, like autoimmune diseases, people have never really made significant progress on. Still very, very challenging. Can you see a time when this type of data, these data clouds, this type of wellness emphasis starts impacting these types of chronic diseases? I'll let Nathan take Nathan, because you talked for a long time a minute ago. So
I think it's his turn.
Yeah, I think we can definitely make inroads into those. So some of the things that are really quite interesting, right, let's take autoimmunity, right, which is not my main subject of expertise, but so in autoimmunity, it's a situation where your immune system makes a mistake, right? It identifies, it's recognized as something foreign, something that's in your actual body, so it's now starting to attack itself, right? It's attacking your body because it has come to believe that a piece of whatever it's looking at is similar to some pathogen or some other issue that it was wanting to clear out. So one of the difficulties there is we have to think about what triggers that autoimmunity. So the space that you have to cover there is vast. So if you're thinking about like the sand of the ocean or on the seashore or the stars in the sky, it's that kind of like huge number of combinations of shapes that you can form in your immune system. In fact, Lee won the Lasker Prize for figuring out how that happened, so it feels like it's a good question for him. So as we do that, though, the really interesting aspect is with new modern technologies, we can understand these processes a lot better. So one is we can computationally fold proteins now, so you can actually get a sense for what kinds of features might be out there that might trigger shapes that will look like a protein that you have in your body. Like that's one thing you can start to imagine that. You can also imagine different ways that you can start to study your exposure to pathogens, germs, or bacteria that you get exposed to. One of the companies here in town, Adaptive Biotechnologies, actually will sequence antibodies that will tell you like the life history of what you've been exposed to. And so some of the things that is quite interesting is that there are all these insults that not only cause autoimmunity in certain cases, but they can also, you can get pathogens that trigger chronic disease by like an insult to your body and all these kind of things, which has been totally invisible to us. I was talking about this with Doug Kell, who runs the equivalent of our National Science Foundation in the United Kingdom. And so some of these things that we just have been invisible to us, where we have these insults and these things that are happening, from the standpoint of monitoring like you do in scientific wellness, now you're looking at all those libraries. Once you make that cheap enough and you can do it routinely, you now have a library of every pathogen that you know that you have been exposed to. And as you start building that with the kind of data clouds we're talking about, now you start having a mapping of what have you been exposed to. There's also something called the exposome, so what you're exposed to in the environment. And if you start coupling that with the kind of data cloud you have in scientific wellness, now all of a sudden you have a map to start to understand what are the things that you've been exposed to that could cause autoimmunity. And because you can do this new protein folding of all the proteins, you can start doing a map of what's out there coupled to the shape of what these look like in your body. And this is a ways away, but all the every piece that I talked about exists today. We just have to scale it, make it more computationally accurate and powerful, and click them together. So there's ways you can think about this.
And I think there's a role. Probably everybody in the room is thinking, just because we've bombarded in the press over the past few months, that with the kind of vast amount of data one can collect on people, that the modern tools of AI and machine learning and what have you are going to play an important role. And I wonder, Lee, so I can imagine pitfalls and I can imagine benefits. Maybe you could talk a little bit about that.
I think the recent advances in AI will turn out to be one of the most powerful forces in bringing data-driven medicine into reality, because as Jim hinted, it will let us handle data in dimensions we couldn't even conceive before. But I think there are a whole series of advances that have been made that are central to this AI idea. First of all, there have been a whole series of studies over the last 5 to 8 years that have gone to the scientific literature and have created what are called knowledge graphs. That is, putting together in graphs the relationship between disease and proteins and genes and messenger RNA and metabolites and all of these different kinds of features. And some of these graphs now are extremely large. They've tied together an enormous amount of knowledge. For example, the Google knowledge graph has 850 billion edges and about 200 billion nodes. So it's an enormous amount of information that's been interconnected. So keep knowledge graphs in mind. A second revolution that's come about are digital twins, and I think this is something Nathan would like to talk about with regard to Alzheimer's. But what a digital twin is a conceptual model. It can be either of wellness or it can be any disease that you'd like to model. And we're at Phenome Health actually building now a digital twin for diabetes. And on the one hand, we put in the physiology and the molecular equations and that we understand about diabetes. And on the other hand, we put in all of the metabolites and biochemistry and clinical insights so that we amass that level of knowledge. And to that, we put in lots and lots of individual data, the genome, phenome data, for example, we talked about in Airfail. And what that will give us is an enormous data set into which we can then do two things. One, create a million models of different human beings and experiment with them and test how changes change the disease if it's diabetes, for example. Or number two, in the future, we'll be able to put the data from an individual patient in and it will analyze and create an ordered list of actionable possibilities for each individual according to their deficiencies. Now, the third point of this triad of interesting possibilities are something called large language models. GPT-4 is an example of this. And this has the ability to manipulate language in ways humans can't even conceive. And in manipulating language, they manipulate information. And the really critical thing about these large language models is if you educate them in the right way, they can become the most powerful tools ever for diagnosis and the discovery of therapies. And the idea that we have and are playing with now is, can we take a large language model that has only been exposed to biomedical data, like all of the literature that exists out there, and add to it these big knowledge graphs, and add to it whatever digital twin models we have, and in this language model then take again the patient that has diabetes and put them in, and this will add yet another dimension to what the digital twins could do. And that's a simple explanation of how we see moving forward in the future. But I would say we ought to let Nathan talk about a digital twin for Alzheimer's that's really done some remarkable things. So, is that okay?
Sure.
Yeah.
So I'm really excited about this. So we've spent, so this is some work we've done at Thorne, where I'm chief science officer, and working with a good colleague also, Tom Patterson, who's been a real driver of a lot of this. But we have developed, I think, one of the first functional digital twin models in the world, and it is a model of how your brain maintains health. And so it starts from a scientific wellness aspect. This is in, you know, we write about this in the book. So in our view, Alzheimer's has been misunderstood for a long time. And the belief for a long time was that Alzheimer's was caused by amyloid plaques, and do not believe that to be true. And so in this conception around Alzheimer's, which has really come, I think, from taking data from about 950 different papers and building a digital twin model, which means we're going to simulate the physiology of the brain, you get something that's very different. I'm just going to explain it at a very high level. So your brain consumes 20% of your body's energy, and it's 2% of your body's biomass. So it's 10 times more metabolically active than an average tissue in your body. And so it's a huge energy hog. So one of the things that you have to do every second of every day is you have to keep your neurons having enough energy to stay alive, a positive energy balance. And as you get older, one of the things that happens, this is why you get Alzheimer's late in your life and not early, is that your ability to perfuse oxygen throughout your brain goes down. Now, as that happens, it becomes harder to keep that positive energy balance, to keep your neurons alive. And so as you get into more hypoxic or low oxygen conditions, then there's another gene that plays a big role in Alzheimer's called ApoE. ApoE4, and so one of the things that matters, I'm giving a little biology here, is that to keep your neurons at high energy when you have low oxygen, it turns out when you do the simulations that you have to keep your cholesterol level in astrocytes low. So ApoE4, which gives you high risk for Alzheimer's, will transport that cholesterol out, but it's really slow. ApoE2 does it quickly. And so if you just calculate the effect of those measured rates of transport and on its effect on the energy generation in neurons, you can recapitulate the age at which every single genotype gets Alzheimer's disease in this simulation. And so that, to me, suggests that this is a really fundamental aspect. Now, the other thing that happens is that as your neurons die, your brain doesn't have enough synapse firing. And as you go below a certain threshold, what happens is that you have to recruit additional synapses to keep cognition going as your synapses have died. So your brain has to secrete a molecule to recruit additional synapses. And what is that molecule? Amyloid beta. So amyloid beta, which we have targeted with over 450 clinical trials and spent $300 billion developing, is not a cause of Alzheimer's. It is a compensatory mechanism, primarily, that is trying to save your brain from underlying metabolic dysfunction. Now, there's some subtleties that I'm skipping here, but that is a fundamental misunderstanding of you're basically trying to fix the car wreck by shooting the ambulance drivers. And so this is a problem that you shouldn't do. And so this is not a good strategy. And so there are subtleties there. There are genetics that point towards amyloid. Amyloid can embed in blood vessels. And so when it does that, it actually constricts blood flow, which falls back to this central mechanism. Anyway, there's a whole ton of things that we've hung on this. But we've compared this against 30 different clinical trials and human research studies in the literature. And what the digital twin lets us do is we can simulate cognition over the course of lifespan. And we've been able to figure out all kinds of interesting and very vital medical conundrums and different things that we could dive into. But I just want to say a couple things about it. So what this digital twin lets us do is we can take data from genetics, blood measures, cognitive assessments, and from that point in time, we can build a probabilistic model, a digital twin of that patient, and show the likely age of dementia diagnosis. And most importantly, we can go through a whole set of potential preventive interventions and predict, not only for them individually, but for all combinations thereof, how many years of benefit in terms of the likelihood of pushing off dementia you can get. And we can predict that on a per person basis from a digital twin. Now, we are going to do a prospective clinical trial to validate this out. We have tested it so far on clinical trial data that's out there. But some really fundamental things come out. So one is that the digital twins in general, when you look at one intervention, a single intervention, which, by the way, virtually all biomedical trials are done this way, the effect size is typically small. But when you start doing these things in combination, the effect size is typically big. So this is a reimagining of the structure of how we should run clinical trials in the prevention space. Because if you try to do them on one intervention, especially if that's a cheap intervention, if it's exercise or sleep or a vitamin or something like this, there's no economic incentive to get to the size of trial that you would need to show a small effect. But if you do these where you're not testing a compound, you're testing a digital twin, you're testing a program, that means you're going to personalize the intervention to every person, the effect size gets larger, and then the number of people you need in the trial gets smaller. This makes preventive medicine trials possible. And so this is what I think is incredibly powerful, is that we now have the ability to understand at a pretty complex level things that we just couldn't see before, because with the digital twins you can simulate clinical trials that would take you thousands of years to run in the real world, simulate what's the right strategy, what's the wrong strategy, and put it all together, and then it lets you choose something that you have high confidence will work, is highly personalized, and then do that in the real world. So this is what I'm probably most excited about these days. And we have now a functioning working model of this to test that I'm super excited about.
So let me, that was a lot of information we covered in the last.
Yeah, it was.
Let me.
Sorry, it was my most passionate.
You had your moment, and you took advantage of it. Thank you. So let me summarize a couple of things that I think were key points here. One was something that Lee made, which is the idea of knowledge graphs. And I think the take-home message from that is that it's not just data that you're putting into something like a digital twin, it's actually knowledge, it's structure, it's something that may not be mechanism, but it hints at mechanism. And then you have the fact that, and both Lee and you referred to this, that in almost any disease setting, whether it's a disease we understand or not, especially over the past decade, there are 1,000 papers that have 1,000 times more information in them than you would have seen a decade ago. And with the advent of computational approaches and AI and this digital twin concept, it's becoming possible to build personalized models of disease that nominally you could have at home. It'd be you, the digital version of you at home. And I think something else that Nathan hinted at, which I think is implied here, is that the world of science is presenting way more hypotheses to medicine now than can be tested. And so there's a lot of interesting ideas coming out about how one can test those ideas. And you know, one field I'm in is cell therapy, where you may design a cell therapy to attack a particular cancer, but you know, because you're a scientist and it's probably going to be the first generation of many generations before you actually cure the disease. But in that one trial, at a subclinical level, you can actually test all your other hypotheses by taking just a handful of those cells and genetically modifying them to test the. And so you can actually give a patient 1,000 drugs at once. 999 of those drugs won't do anything clinically, but our measurement tools are enough that one can actually begin measuring them. And this is a conversation going on with the FDA. But something that strikes me about all of this stuff, it's exciting world, and I think it is happening even as we speak. But if you walk into Swedish Medical Center or UW Hospital, it's not obvious it's happening.
Well, it isn't happening.
Yeah, that's exactly.
Yeah.
And so, in my experience, if you have something that's successful, physicians will alter their practice because they want to make people better. I'm sure you've given thoughts. How do you go about turning this big battleship of reactive healthcare into something that is modernized? I mean, we no longer shop the way we used to. Everything else has been modernized. Healthcare is the same.
Okay. Great question, Jim. So I'll give you two answers. If you think about the five major challenges of healthcare today, they are quality, the aging population, the explosion of chronic diseases, the need for racial heterogeneity in the data populations, and cost, okay? What I would say is the million person project we're really pushing will beautifully answer each of those questions in really interesting ways. So with that as a background, what we've done, I went recently and spoke to a meeting that had 25 CEOs from many of the largest healthcare systems around the entire US. And I pitched this idea of scientific wellness and prevention and raised the issue of how we're going to be able to carry out this terrifying shift for healthcare systems from disease orientation with all the profit motives and everything to wellness and prevention. And I made a number of suggestions about ways that this might get started. And at the end, I said, I hope one of you will have the nerve to come up and talk with me and perhaps agree to explore possible steps one could take in moving toward this direction. And I had one CEO who, number one, had already started to do some amazing things with actionable possibilities in the genome. And he pushed them personally himself and had them integrated into this healthcare system. And two, he was about to bequeath $5 billion that there were no constraints on. So I said to him, I know how I can help you spend this so you can really make a difference. So he is going to come out in July, and we're going to talk about this kind of possibility. And what is absolutely incredible about this system is it's, you know, it's reasonable size. It's in the 5 to 7 million-ish range. But the really important thing is it has an integrated payer-provider system. Because if we can solve those five problems I spoke about initially, especially the chronic disease and the aging problems, we can save the healthcare system enormous amounts of money. But the savings, at least initially, will go primarily to payers. So the providers will suffer from not getting these benefits unless, as his system, they're integrated together and they can share these kind of benefits. So I'm really staking a lot on I can persuade this person to take a gamble and take some actionable steps forward in pushing not only actionable possibilities from the genome, but genome analyses as well. And if you have a system that's doing very well, and his is doing extremely well, and you can integrate these things in and you can begin to achieve the increased quality and the increased cost saving, I'll argue other systems are going to be forced to follow in their footsteps. Now, I've made it sound simpler than it's going to be, but that is one real hope I have for getting actions done in the shorter term future and not in a 15-year future.
Okay, well, I was going to ask you a question, but your answer was sufficiently encompassing that you actually answered the question I was going to ask from the audience. So I'm going to ask the next question. So I'll ask this to either one of you. And this is a question about priorities. Since we don't address problems until they become symptomatic, until you have something acute, if you were going to start to test or measure something now to assess your health or wellness state, what would be the top one, two, three things you would measure?
Yeah, I can certainly.
And how would you interpret them, I guess, is also.
Yeah. So there's all kinds of things that you can measure. So one that I think is really important is the gut microbiome. So gut health issues affect between 60 and 70 million Americans. So we have lots of, so let's see, there's 300 million. So let's see, well, fifth of us. So this part of the room is like has gut issues or kind of that size. So we have a lot of those problems. Sometimes we might not even appreciate the degree that we have some of those issues because we've grown used to a certain kind of discomfort, and you might only find that, you know, after that's relieved. So I do believe in microbiome testing. I think it's very useful. We do have a gut health test at Thorne that we do, and there's a number of others out there. So it's easily accessible for people, and you can find out, you know, a wide variety of different things as the gut, which affects your digestion. You can look at, there are certain nutrients that are made primarily in your gut. There are certain neurotransmitters that are made primarily in your gut, like serotonin, for example. You can get a lot of information. It affects massively your health across many scales. And for those people in the room who are maybe in the Aravail program, for example, got into a discussion around this, like the gut health test that we have now is like 100 times better than what we had
in Aravail. Not, you know, we did as good a job as we possibly could in Aravail, but it was early. We didn't know that much. You fast forward to now, we know radically more. So this is a test that I think is really useful for understanding health now. A second really good way to go about this is through testing biological age. The way that we've done it is through about 40 different clinical lab tests. So these are some of the kind of things that your doctor might measure, but it analyzes it in the context of your age and gender and kind of what your, or your sex and what your, you know, these different variables, and then analyzes where you're at for your point in life. And you can see if you're a 45-year-old, are you, biological age can be, you know, is it younger, is it older, how are you trending, what's going on? I think that's a useful measure. And then some of the other things that are coming online, which are not quite here yet, but I think are exciting, are some of these global metabolomics and proteomics tests. And some of these are gonna be hitting the market probably within the next year or so, where you're gonna be able to make, you know, on the order of 1,000 different measurements off a device that you can have at home, essentially painlessly, and you can get access to a wide variety of information. We're in the process of doing learning across those right now to figure out how to read health signals. Some of that's known and some of that is emerging. But there's all kinds of ways that you can dive in right now and start to understand many facets of your health. Hormone health is, you know, another really big one that people look at and so forth. So there's many, many things you could dive into.
Let me add one more to that, if I could, Jim. And that's the idea that we now have the ability, if we follow your blood analytes every 6 months, to discover people who transition from wellness to disease have proteins that are off scale, high in expression, that signal the earliest detectable transition of disease up to 3 or 4 years prior to a clinical diagnosis. In the Aravail population, we had almost 200 of these transitions. We looked at 10 of them that transitioned to cancer. All of them had these kinds of proteins. In the million person project, we estimate 200,000 such transitions. So what that, those data will give us are the markers and unerringly predict the chronic disease much later that's to come. And they'll give us a time point at which we can begin to think about therapies. And the daring idea is, wouldn't it be incredible if we could prevent 20, then 50, then 75% or more of the chronic diseases before ever they get started? And these were proteins that we were looking at in the blood that gave us these markers. So there are many powerful things that can put us in the preventive stage. And the other point I'll make about chronic diseases is we spent last year about $4.4 trillion on healthcare. 86% of it went to chronic diseases. Suppose you could get rid of 50% of them in 10 to 15 years. That's the kind of savings we're talking about.
Okay. I'm going to answer one question myself.
Go for it.
So if you, I'm going to ask permission from you guys if I can answer a question
myself. I super look forward to it.
Okay. Yeah. So there's a question related to, you know, we've had a lot of discussions of aspirational technologies and, you know, and mechanisms for enacting them. And I'll tell you an unusual mechanism that we're working on now that you wouldn't think this would be relevant, but I think it's actually highly relevant. If you are a cancer patient and you live more than, say, 30 minutes or 40 minutes from a major medical center, you're in serious trouble. You're likely not going to get into a clinical trial. You're likely working with physicians who are not doing state-of-the-art therapy, and in fact, physicians that are intrinsically uncomfortable with some of the most modern and effective therapies. And so this has been recognized. And whether you're in an urban, rural community or a ethnically underserved community, your healthcare is very subpar. I think everybody in this room knows this. And there's a big push in the U.S. right now to try to raise those standards. And there's even a big push on the financial side, because pharma companies are tired of trying out their clinical trials on a narrow window of people and finding that when they actually take them out to who the broad people who would be their customers, they don't work as well. So you're not going to do this with bricks and mortar. You're going to have to use the types of tools we've talked about today to raise the level of healthcare in these environments. And in fact, we're working now with the Providence Healthcare System and also with ARPA-H. And hopefully it's a program that we'll be able to launch later this summer, to try to bring these tools as a way of raising the standard of healthcare in places that where you can't actually come in and build a medical center. It's the only option. And so I think it may be an example of a bad situation actually catalyzing a really terrific solution. And once you bring these technologies in, then you've brought them in. And then it's just generation two, generation three, and you have a real opportunity to change things. I think that's actually a pretty exciting thing to contemplate. So that's the question I'm going to answer. I'm not going to answer any more questions. I'm just going to ask them. But I wanted to answer that one. So for the digital twin, have you considered factoring in environmental exposures? Or I guess maybe either Lee or Nathan. So a digital twin comes out of like an engine. You know, like when Boeing develops an engine, they develop a digital twin so they can predict how the engine will behave. Probably we don't do that with the whole body yet, do we? You would do it with an organ or a disease state or a disease site, right, or something like
that's
that?
That's correct.
And then what, you know, or I don't know, a chronic disease, what do you rank order? Where does environmental exposures come in as a factor?
Well, I think that's really an important question. The simple answer is I think environmental exposures are really underscored. In Airville, we looked at heavy metals that were poisonous, like mercury that you get from eating too much tuna fish. And that's a simple diagnosis and a simple therapy, namely stop eating raw tuna or any kind of tuna that has high mercury in it. A really interesting environmental contaminant we're studying, we're going to be studying, we've got a couple of grants in on it now, is to look at the effect wildfire smoke has on pregnancy. And we've done similar studies on the effect of COVID on pregnancy with really interesting results. And it turns out that pregnancy is unfortunately a most sensitive assay system. That is, in what happens to the mother as well as what happens to the fetus to assay for toxins like this. And because we now have a lot of satellite data on smoke in the West, we can cover wide populations in Oregon and California and time them against pregnancies and determine exposures and follow these pregnancies and see what the outcomes were both for mothers and infants. So that's the kind of thing I think is going to be important in the future. There is a division at NIH that essentially specializes in looking at environmental toxins, and I think that's going to be a very important area. One of the unfortunate things is the analyses we do in blood for toxins and things like that are rather expensive compared to the costs of protein analysis and simple metabolite analysis. So there is a need to get better technologies to be able to measure the effects of environment. But I think the wildfire smoke is going to be an incredibly important assay with regard to what it does to us.
Okay, so I'm going to, there's a lot of questions here. This is a pretty impatient audience, and they want to know what they can have now. So I'm not going to quite ask that question, but I think I'm going to conclude by asking each of you to, first Nathan, then Lee, to comment on if we could point to something in 5 years that we don't have now that comes out of this. I think this vision of medicine we've been talking about here today is inevitable. But it's going to be the, I think it's going to be the kind of thing where if you're in a canoe and you're going across a lake, it seems like it's really slow until you look behind you and you actually see that you've actually made a lot of distance. And so 5 years out, Nathan, what's going to be different?
So I think I kind of want to take that in two parts if possible, because I kind of want to say a little bit about what's now and then what's 5 years, because I do think
that's like it's an impatient audience. They would like to hear what's now.
That's right. So we want to, because, you know, we like to talk a lot about the future, but exactly like what do you walk away with? What can you do? So one of the things that, you know, I do want to point out is, you know, so the company that we have, so, you know, Thorne Health Tech, which is a personalized scientific wellness company. So we're working on building these things. And we do work with 47,000 physicians and 5 million customers today. So it is not like, you know, nothing from that standpoint. So, you know, so things like if you want to test your microbiome and learn what to do, you can get that right now. Thorne.com. So you can get that if you'd like. If you want to do a biological age test, or you can do it from someone else, right? But you can do, like, if you want to do a biological age test, you can do that right now. There's all kinds of compounds that you can that are quite interesting that you can take now in regards to aging. One of the really interesting ones was is taurine. I don't know if you read this in the news in the last week. So taurine is a non-canonical amino acid. It is a and there was a paper published in Science, so arguably the best scientific journal in the world, last week. And so taurine goes down as you age. But taurine, you know, and it's associated with all these aging-related diseases, but we don't know, like, is it causal? So this group set out, and they did experiments in C. elegans model, which is a worm, a mouse model, and non-human primates. And they did a huge study, like I said, published in Science, biggest journal, best journal in the world, arguably. And it showed that if you give it to the mice, they live 10 to 12% longer. So that would be the equivalent of like 9 extra years for a human. They gave it to the worms. They similarly lived longer. And they did it to non-human primates, so very close to us, close as you can get really in experiments. And they didn't do longevity in that sense because it takes a while because they also live quite a long time. But they looked at all kinds of blood chemistry and measures, and they get appreciably very much healthier. So for example, there are many things like this that you don't have the gold standard evidence of like a long-term clinical trial yet in humans. You can wait 20 years and see. But taurine you can buy for $8, $8 a month. You can have supplies of this stuff. So there's different things that you can think about. Nicotinamide riboside, which is an NAD booster, also very interesting. And on and on. So there's many things that you can do to start thinking proactively about, you know, are there elements that you can think about to have an impact on your health? Coming back to the brain health model, some of the things that, you know, end up being important, there's a compound called phosphatidylcholine. It's found in eggs. People who eat diets rich in phosphatidylcholine get Alzheimer's 3 years later than people who don't. And when we did the whole digital twin simulation I was telling you about before, one of the predictions out of that model is that under these low oxygen conditions, it predicts that you run out of phosphatidylcholine. It becomes rate limiting. That's when we went into, and there's all kinds of danger going in the nutrition literature and just machine learning, but we go in there with one hypothesis and you look it up and it's like, oh, okay, there's a differential.
you're 28% less likely to get Alzheimer's if you eat a diet rich in phosphatidylcholine, et cetera. And we do go through a lot of this in the book. So those are all things you can do immediately today, easy, low cost, makes a difference, bunch of papers about it, and so forth. So there's a lot you can do already in terms of, you know, so optimizing your microbiome, your blood chemistry, your biological age, some of the compounds I mentioned that have pretty good evidence behind them. So there's many things that I think you can do today. Now in 5 years, so what I really see us being in 5 years, I'm gonna come back to my my favorite topic these days. Well, there's three things. There's three trends that I think really matter. And Lee alluded to them before. One is that we're going to be able to do these multi-omic measurements, and it's going to be in your house, relatively inexpensive, and very data-rich. At Thorne, we've also developed an at-home, essentially painless blood draw device called the OneDraw, and you know, putting all the tests on it, so you can get that within, be a lot less than 5 years, you can get access to very simple, easy blood measures, cheaply at home. We'll have we're already doing it for research. We've done it on tens of thousands of people already. It's approved in 5 countries for direct to consumer. Like, this is going out in those places. Second big trend is the digital twins I talked about. So we will be getting out those on brain health likely next year. There's, you know, some steps to get that in motion. We'll have diabetes, we'll have obesity, we'll have skin health. This will just cascade. And like I mentioned, this is going to allow for very detailed personalization. We will be building that most likely into something like a clinical decision support system to help doctors and actually funnel so that they can use that in their practices to have access to this. That will be done within 5 years. And then the third thing, which will be done within 5 years, which actually probably sooner, is this implementation of these large language models. And Lee alluded to this. The degree of personalization you can do now compared to even what was available a year ago is unthinkable, right? You will be able to, and this, you know, this is gonna be there by next year. You can already do it to some degree. Instead of filling out long questionnaires, you can literally just talk to this thing, tell it, you know, what your issue is, what your problem is, and so forth. We can already populate that into a database and extract information from that, and then tether that to, you know, these deep, you know, the knowledge graphs are also these just deep context about health, and give you, and you can get back personalized responses. You can do it totally confidentially too, with no one in the loop, and just ask those. So you start clicking those things together, the multiomics, the digital twins, and the personalization through these models, and you can develop a preventive health system on anything that, you know, doesn't require you like going into the hospital or being in that physical sense. You can develop that's way more cost effective than today, way more scalable than today, way more effective. And so I think those are the nuggets that will let us build the preventive health program of the future. And I honestly think all those things are doable within 5 years. So I think 5 years looks pretty good on that front.
So Lee, I don't think he did, but did he miss anything?
Yeah.
Okay.
No, what I would talk about is your genome probably has 15,000 actionable possibilities collectively. I mean, individually, you'll have a very small subset of those things. But all of them are things that are really necessary to know. And they fall into 5 really interesting categories. So one category are 82 variants that the American College of Medical Genetics has identified. And a really interesting one is one called malignant hypothermia. This is a single gene defect, which if you have, and if you take the wrong anesthetic, it will trigger a hyperthermic reaction that is irreversible and kills you. And the simple solution is to know you have it and to say, these are the anesthetics that you cannot be exposed to. And there are 82 other ones like that, that if not you, your doctor should know about those so you can be warned appropriately. A second category of things is there are probably 200 gene variants now that affect how, if you have one of them, you can react effectively with drugs. These are called pharmacogenomic variants. Many of them are very well validated. They're almost not used at all, except for a few very rare examples. Another is a series that has become very popular called rare diseases, which 80% of which are single gene defects. And frankly, we should be doing your genome at birth so we know from the very beginning whether you have one of those defects, because a large number of them express themselves early in development and so forth. And there are some other ones that we won't talk about. But my prediction is within 5 years, with this integration of knowledge graphs, digital twins, and large language models that I talked about, we'll be able to deliver your genome to this large language appropriately educated model, and it will be able to give your physician back every single one of those 15,000 variants you have, explaining, one, what the actionable possibility is, if we know it, in some cases we won't, but two, it'll give the evidence for the physician so they can really be validated that it's bona fide. And this is one of the things we're going to start with this big healthcare system that we've talked about, I talked about earlier. So I really see what natural large language models are going to be able to do is to make an ordinary physician in the future into a specialist for almost every single discipline that is being able to carry out the right actions on an enormous diversity of different kinds of diseases.
Wow. Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
I think we are done now, but I think you two guys will be willing to hang around and chat a little bit. There was a lot of questions we didn't get to, so feel free.
Sure.
Thank you all very much. Oh, and I want to make sure I thank Town Hall for hosting us. They've been a great partner for the past many years, and it's absolutely spectacular opportunity that they provide us with, and we try to provide them with good scientific content. So thank you, Town Hall.